you're brilliant and you're so fun. No, you are, though, and you're so much fun. You, like, do all the cool things. You're, like, one of the cool kids. I mean, you hang out with the cartoon guys.
Well, I do hang out with the cartoon guys. That is pretty cool. They let me do that. They're nice. They feel sorry for me.
Well, I don't think that's it. I think they let you hang out with them because you're cool. You're just that cool.
Or maybe I owe them money.
What is your favorite part of the writing process?
Oh, that's easy. Revision. I love to revise. That's after all the hard work is done and you get to go in there and move things around. It's like decorating.
Then what would be your most miserable part of writing? The part you just really, it's painful.
Yeah, I guess that would be getting started. You know, I mean, it's like, it's really fun when you have the idea in your head and you're thinking about it, but then that first time when you sit down and maybe you've already done an outline, I always do outlines, and you have to start writing, then it becomes real, and that becomes real hard for me. I get writer's block all the time, but I just have to push through it. I mean, for me, writing is my job, and so I don't have time to really fool around with it. So I give myself goals, like, you know, so many words per week or something like that, and I try to stick to them. Well, you just got to do it, and knowing, you know, it might even be awful, or it probably will be awful, especially first couple of times around. You know, my first drafts are just, you know, So you just put it out there and know that, you know, you're going to get to that revision, which is the fun part, eventually.
What would your best advice be for new writers?
Just to keep going and not worry about, you know, that your first thing that you write has to be brilliant. I mean, I think the most important thing is to just get something done on paper. Once it's done on paper, you can fuss over it and do anything with it. But when you're staring at a blank piece of paper or a blank computer screen, if you don't start, it's you know, the longer you wait, the harder it's going to be.
Do you think that most new writers get more hung up on the process of getting published?
I do. You know, I teach a lot of writing classes and I talk to a lot of writers, and a lot of the new ones say, you know, my goal is to get published. It's never, I want to write a great book, or I want to write a great story, or I want to write a great sentence. It's, I want to get published.
The importance of an online presence and websites and Facebook and Twitter.
Like, big on blogs.
Yeah.
So I read about, or I subscribe to about maybe 60 blogs. I love reading people's blogs about books. I mean, I just eat those things up, and I'm on Facebook all the time. It's like a bad habit. Well, actually, it's a good habit because it's a lot of fun, and I get to connect with other authors and readers and writers. And sometimes I'll even go to Facebook and ask for help and something I'm working on. So,
okay, so how would you recommend somebody go about developing a web presence?
Well, I guess first of all, if you're a published writer, you have to have a website. I mean, that's number one. You know, it's a resource for your readers. If you know, if you're in the children's publishing industry like I am, it's great for students to go to or to get in contact with you. So that's something you need to have. I am, you know, like, horrible with computers, but I created my own website, lisayee.com, on a Mac. So if I can do that, anybody can do that. Blogs are fun, but you don't have to have one. But they're great if you do. But if you have one, you need to keep it up. You can't just have a blog and then not write something for 3 months, because people won't want to come and visit you if you're never home. And Facebook's fun. I don't Twitter, though. I keep thinking I should do that, but I'm not a Twitter tweeter.
How can a new writer make the most out of an SCBWI membership? I know that you're sitting on the board now.
Oh, SCBWI is terrific. I mean, that's how I got my start, by going to the conferences. And even if you can't make it to a conference, like a national conference in LA or New York, although I highly recommend you go to those, there are state conferences and regional conferences. You can participate in the discussion boards 24/7. You know, ask any question. There are published authors on there, like myself. I'm on there all the time. Just a couple of weeks ago, on one of my local SCBWI events, we had a critique nick where published authors critiqued members' manuscripts in progress and for free. You know, so there are lots of things you can do with SCBWI.
Here's a real serious question. When will Apple lift the moratorium they've imposed on you for buying their products?
I don't think ever. I think Apple is not happy with me because I destroy their products. I love them, though, and it just doesn't love me. And when I destroy it, and then I blog about it, and it makes them look bad. And I don't mean to make them look bad. But see, my theory is that I use so many Apple products, and I'm you know, using them all the time, that the rate of chaos is higher. You know, because I'm using it. It's like if you drive a lot, you know, the chances are that you'll have an accident.
Millicent.
Mm-hmm.
Loved Millicent. Your next was Stanford.
That's right.
And I loved Stanford. Really
Thank
loved
you.
That book. Next is Emily. And this is written in letters to her father.
That's
which is fun. And, oh, and over here I've got Absolutely Maybe. Love the title. Sweet, sweet story.
That was fun to write. I really enjoyed that one.
The voice. You could tell the voice was so much fun all the way through it. We've got this one, which is Great Middle Grade. Fun. Loved the tree and stuck onto that tree.
Thank you.
And you've got a sequel to this one coming out when?
It's coming out in September this year. It's called Bobby the Brave Sometimes.
Yeah, and this one is Bobby versus Girls Accidentally. I love those little subtitles. And I love Dan's goldfish on the back.
Dan is a great illustrator.
He is really wonderful. That's his work right behind you there with you munching on a donut.
Mm-hmm.
And then you've got a story in this.
Geektastic, yeah.
And I'm a suck-up because I have all of them.
I have an American Girl novel out.
That's right, with the doll.
Yeah, there's a doll, and the book's called Good Luck, Ivy.
If a unicorn moved into your yard and crapped 100 pounds of glittered, puffed poo every day, what would you do with the poo or the unicorn?
Well, see, if it were 105 pounds, I'd know what to do, but it's just 100 pounds?
It could be 105 if you could do more with that extra 5.
Okay,
I think if you feed them a little more, I think they would crap a little more.
Okay, I would probably sell it on eBay.
If you were lucky, the picture of Jesus could be glittered.
Could appear in the poo?
Yeah.
Yeah, that's possible. That happens sometimes.
And how did your brief stint as high priestess of the Pug Pug tribe of New Guinea Pigland influence your writing? And also, would you encourage others to eat the raw liver of the endangered ginger snap dragon and invite the locals to worship them too?
You know, I get asked that question a lot. And I would say don't eat the endangered liver because, first of all, it's poisoned. But second, it's endangered, and you don't want to mess with endangered things. So
bad karma.
Bad karma. And the way it affected my writing was it made me more of a deep thinker, just thinking about that whole experience.
So,
like I said, you know, I mean, how often can you get the liver question? But you know, fine, another liver question. That's it. You know.
Somebody accused you of replacing Pee-Pee. Is that the true Pee-Pee? The one and only true Pee-Pee?
This is her. This is her. I mean, you can't fake something like this.
I don't know. There was a lot of strong evidence.
And she's in her her Mr. Darcy dress. Not that Mr. Darcy wears this, but this is what she wears when she sees Mr. Darcy.
You never know. Mr. Darcy might wear a dress like that. You just don't know about it.
Well, I do, but I told him I wouldn't say.
Okay. Well, okay, then I'll keep secret safe with me. As safe as anything else. And Julie
Winkler.
Yeah, Julie Winkler made that for you, didn't she?
Yes.
Very cute. Hi, Pee-Pee. She's so cute.
She thinks so.
Thank you so much, Lisa. Well, now that we've Skyped, can we be best friends forever now, Lisa? Can we?
No, that's okay.
Okay.
Oh, I'm sure it is, but I... Yeah.
But
I am not going to do that. That is so weird.